following is a video presentation of a worship service at Orrville Baptist Church.
Well, good morning. He is risen. He is risen indeed. We wish a happy resurrection day to all of you this morning. And we pray that you're jubilant, for Christ is risen just as he said. No matter where you are today, no matter how you're feeling, no matter what the weather is like where you are, take comfort in the fact this morning that Jesus is alive. We welcome you to this worship service this morning. To those that are visiting with us on our stream today, we send Easter tidings to you. We pray first and foremost that if you don't know the Lord and Savior today, that today would be the day that you come to know Him as personal Lord and Savior. We also pray this morning that if you do not have a church home, that you would join us as soon as we're able to gather back together. We'd love to have you as part of this very sweet fellowship. We have only just a few announcements for you this morning. First, as we noted a little bit earlier this week, the church is going to remain closed through April the 30th with virtual worship services only. We feel that right now this is the best course of action for us to take at this time. We will reevaluate before the first Sunday in May to see how the situation is at that point in time. We hope that you'll tune in to those virtual worship services and that we'll all be able to gather together again real soon. Secondly, we've met and surpassed our Annie Armstrong Easter offering goal, so we praise the Lord for that this morning, and we thank everybody that gave to this great, great missions offering. And lastly, if you will, continue to remember our online giving platform. You can access that by going to our church website at orvillebaptist.com. It's a great, quick, safe, efficient way to give during this time. We hope that you'll check it out and begin to use it. Continue to remember all those that are on our prayer list this morning for all the different needs that are in our church right now. Remember, if you know of any updates that you have, please let the prayer team know so that we can get those updates sent out to everyone. Even though the buildings are closed, the church is still at work. Its members are still active. So if there's any way that we can assist you, that we can help you during this time, if you have any need, please let your church family know so that we can know how to minister to you best. And lastly, we ask that we join together in prayer for all of those that are affected by this virus, all of the frontline workers, the people that are working day in and day out to make sure that essential businesses still go and that people are cared for and looked after. We want to pray for them this morning and wish those that are infected with this virus a very speedy recovery and wish our country a very speedy recovery. Before we go forward in the service, let's take a moment to bow together for a time of prayer.
Let us pray. Father God, thank you for this time that we're able to gather by this means of virtual church and these recordings. And I give you praise that we're able to gather for Easter in this manner, knowing this is the first time ever that we have as a church not been able to meet on Easter. As far as I know, in the United States, this is the first time ever. But God, we know that you're present with us, and we know that as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that it's a great time for us to rejoice in our salvation and to rejoice in the fact that you live in us to glorify yourself through us out in this world. And now may, as we bring your word this morning, may it not fall on deaf ears, but may we be hearers and doers of the word. And thank you as we celebrate Easter. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen.
Come and pray.
Listen to the Word of God this morning from the book of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 1 through 9. And the Bible says, "Now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the women, 'Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come and see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And indeed he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you.' So they went out quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy, and ran to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, 'Rejoice!' So they came and held him by the feet and worshiped him."
Thank you. 13, because he lives. 2:13, we're going to stand and sing the first and last verses.
If you will, please, take your Bibles there at home or wherever you are, or if you cannot get to a Bible at the moment, would you listen as I read about what Paul has to say concerning Easter. This is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning with verse 12. 1 Corinthians 15, 12. Paul says, "Now if Christ is preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ was not risen," or is not risen. "And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is vain, and our faith is also vain. Yea, we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not, if it be so that the dead are not raised. For now if the dead are not raised, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ is not raised, your faith is in vain. You are still in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we, all of us, are of all men most miserable." Father, open our minds and our hearts as we think about this subject that you have burned deep inside of me, Lord, this message you have given for me to share. If there were no Easter. In the name of Jesus, amen. Consider that question. What if there was no Easter? It's an unthinkable question in reality. But what if? What if there has not been an Easter? What if death has conquered and Christ has still in the tomb? He's still laying in the tomb somewhere. What if the soldiers perhaps stole away the body of Christ? What if the Jews had paid the soldiers to hide away Christ? What if, what if, what if, what if? What if Christ was not resurrected? There is no resurrection of Christ from the grave. What if? Well, here's what Paul says. In 1 Corinthians 15, 4 that I read a moment ago, he says that our preaching is in vain. He's saying we're just wasting our time. I'm wasting my time. You're wasting your time. I'm wasting my time here preaching this morning by the means of this video. If Christ is not risen, it's just a waste of my time and your time. I gave up a wonderful job that I had as a very young man in the machine shop with a great future ahead, making top money. And I left to go to my first church, Crestview Baptist Church in Fountain Inn, with way under half the pay that I was receiving, with no insurance and no retirement, no anything. And I had it all at my employment. And here, think about it. How I'm just wasting my time, wasting my life away. I'm 76 year old now and been preaching this gospel for way over 50 years. And it's just been ridiculous. There's no profit to it at all if Christ is not risen. It's vain, it's empty, it's ridiculous, it's offensive, it's no good. And Paul's making it very plain. Paul says that we're just preaching a lie. If Christ is not raised from the grave, then everything that we're doing is in vain and it's a lie. The great preachers of old, you take Dwight L. Moody and Billy Sunday and Charles Spurgeon and Billy Graham, etc.
They all just wasted their time. If Christ is not risen. Well, then in verse 14, Paul also says this, your faith is also vain. Now, our preaching, my preaching, all the preachers that preach, if Christ is not risen from the grave, then it is ridiculous. But your faith is also in vain. What does it matter if Christ is not raised? Faith, here it is, that it's just foolish if Christ is not raised. It is that it's worthless if Christ is still in the grave. You know, when I visit the grave of my mom and my dad and my wife's mom and her dad and my grandparents, etc., it is that I can talk to them all I want to at the graveside. But guess what? I never get an answer. And it would be the same if Christ was not risen or raised from the grave. Then it's still that everything about your faith and mine is over, it's vain. Christ is just dead, it's the end, there's nothing else, all's gone, and our faith is in vain if Christ is not raised from the grave. Now the disciples, Paul says in verse 15 of Corinthians 15, yea, we are found false witnesses of Christ. Paul is saying, I'm just a false witness. As one of those apostles, he says, I'm not just mistaken, I'm a liar. Paul is saying that all of us are just liars if we go out telling people that Jesus was raised from the grave on the third day. But Paul is saying that here we are, we're no better than a con man. He's saying that Peter, a disciple, he was a con man. John was just a crook. And Paul's saying, I'm a liar. If Christ is still in the grave, then the disciples are deceivers. Now, I've been deceived a few times in my life, and probably you have. But the greatest deception would be if Christ is not risen. Then Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 17, he says, and if Christ is not raised, your faith is vain. You are still in your sins. If Christ is not raised, you just think you have been forgiven. You just think you have new life. You just think that this is all real. If Christ is not raised, then God did not accept the death of Christ on Calvary. It would be that Christ was just some kind of religious fanatic who had a martyr complex and ended up being crucified. If there's no resurrection, there's no Savior. If there's no Savior, there's no forgiveness of sin. And if there's no resurrection, Christ's death cannot save anybody as we put faith and trust in him, or we are just still in sin. Still in sin. Well, then Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, 18, then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ have perished. What Paul's saying is that death is the end if Christ is not raised. It's just like a dog or a cat or a rat or a gnat or a mosquito or a fly. It's the end. You're dead. Paul's saying that if you do not believe in the resurrection, and if there is no resurrection, then it's over. Perished. If there's no resurrection, it's over. Now, I've talked about my mom and dad in the grave, and my wife's mom and dad and grandparents, etc. If you've had loved ones who died, then they're just dead if there's no resurrection. So in reality, Paul seems to be saying that if there's no resurrection, nothing really matters. There's no hell. There's no heaven. I just go live it up. If everything is in this life only and death is the end, and there is no judgment day, there is no consequences to our sin, there is no Lamb's Book of Life, there is no resurrection, and when we die, it's over. Now, Paul in 1 Corinthians 15, 19, he says this, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. Without the resurrection, we're not just poor, we're not just fools, but we are miserable. Now, I know some Christians who live pretty miserable in this life because they try to keep sin pretty close by and toy with it a little bit and then on the other side try to live for Christ, and that's miserable. But if this life is all there is and Christ was not risen from the grave, then, my friend, we are of all people most miserable. Given of our tithes and our offerings, which every Christian, if we are true born-again Christian walking in the Spirit of God, should be doing, if we're faithful unto Christ and trust in Him, we will be givers unto the Lord. And the tithe is just a benchmark. But here it is, that if all we have is our hope in Christ while we live here on this earth and there's nothing else, the grave is the end, then Paul says we're miserable. And we are. If Christ is still in the grave, nothing really matters. As a matter of fact, there won't be a second coming if Christ is still in the grave. Paul says that we're just liars. In essence, he's saying that the infallible, inerrant word of God is just a book of lies. Because you see, from Genesis to Revelation, it's about Christ, God's Son coming. It is that God planned this. And if you know the history of Israel and how that God brought about with Abraham coming out of the human line and God calling him out and beginning the Jewish nation, and how it was that God promised the land, and how that in the history of this after World War I, that God, through the Valdor Agreement, I think it's called, from England, that there was the establishment of the coming back. And then after World War II with England, there was, through the documents that were there, to give the land back to Israel and to see all of this. But it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter at all. What the Bible has given us in prophecy from Genesis all the way to Revelation that are being fulfilled and have been fulfilled and are being fulfilled in this very moment. And I'm not so sure that this coronavirus is not a fulfilling of these prophecies of preparing for the return of the Christ to come back to this world. Who would have ever thought that the world would be brought to its knees in such a way, and with this 5G thing they have out now, how that is bringing together everything. You look and see that it's preparing for the coming of Christ, but if He's not risen, He's not coming back, and the Bible's just lying to us about all of this. Maybe we did. If Christ is not raised, maybe we did evolve from monkeys. Maybe we come as slime out of the ocean and over eons of time developed into some kind of other crawling creatures, and finally monkeys and finally humans. Maybe if Christ is not raised, maybe that's how we have our life. However, however, may I tell you the truth? May I tell you the fact? Paul says in this passage I read in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 20,
He gives the conjunction word, but. And listen to what he says. Paul says, but now, good news. Now Christ is raised from the dead and become the first fruits of all those who sleep in Christ. Hallelujah. My preaching and the preaching of all the other preachers that preach the gospel around this world, it's not ridiculous. It's the truth. Your faith is not in foolishness. Your faith is real, and faith is the way we come unto Christ, trusting him, believing in him, in his virgin birth, his sinless life, his death on the cross, and yes, his resurrection. Your faith is not foolish. The disciples, they're not deceivers. Hey, these men walked with Christ on this earth. They saw the Christ as he dies on the cross. And they saw the Christ, they witnessed him from resurrection Sunday for all of his days. Touching him, eating with him, the Christ risen. The disciples are not deceivers. Sin is not sovereign. If Christ is raised, and he is, your faith in Christ and you're asking him to forgive you of sins are covered under his blood, and you are coming to the Christ washed in the blood, sinless, justified, just as if you never sinned. Christ, the resurrected Savior. Death hath no dominion. Oh, yes. We'll die unless we are alive at the coming of the Lord, the second coming, and we're raptured up. But here it is, that death hath no dominion over us at that moment, in that twinkling of the eye, and even quicker than that, when you draw your last breath, when your heart beats the last beat, instantly you're with the Lord. And hallelujah, you're in that sweet oneness with the Christ now in a new way, and have eternity to spend with the Lord. May I share with you that your future is not fearful. Yeah, there's all kind of fear around in this coronavirus, but we really don't have to be full of fear. We just be able to be full of faith and full of trust in the Lord. And if the Lord does allow us to die, hallelujah, we're going to heaven if we know the Christ, the risen Savior. Heaven's real. The Bible is all truth. I'm so confirmed in that. I'm so convinced of that, that God's word is infallible, inerrant, and all of the other things you could say about its truth without any mixture of error, that the Bible gives us from Genesis to Revelation, God's plan. And God's plan for you right now is to receive Christ, this resurrected Savior, if you don't know him. Now, let me say to all of us who do know him, that what a reminder for us on this Easter, as we celebrate the fact that our Savior is raised, and he's alive, and he's here, and the Holy Spirit of God draws us unto him. And may it be that we have a renewal of our surrender unto him. And I know this, the future of the church is great. The future of Orrville Baptist Church is great.
We have the resurrected Savior, and He's in charge. If we will faith it, and we will trust Him, God will, and God is faithful. Father, thank you for this Easter. Thank you for this time that we have had to worship together by this means of virtual church. Thank you for Sam and all of those who have worked putting this together, but especially for Sam doing all that he does in these productions and so much more. But we give you praise, God, and we lift up the Christ, and we know as the Christ is lifted up, you'll draw all people unto you. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen.
With us today in this service, and as a result of what we have learned about Easter, if you don't know Christ as your Savior, would you possibly consider opening up your heart and by faith believing in Jesus, that He was born of a virgin and that He lived the sinless life and died on Calvary's tree for you, and then thank God on Sunday morning, Easter, Jesus arose from the grave, and He will save you if you pray and ask Jesus into your heart. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this service today. I have enjoyed being a part of Orrville Baptist Church, and I'm excited about being here as a part of this ministry as interim pastor. And I pray now, Father, that anyone that has heard this message and does not know Jesus, that they'll pray and ask Jesus to be their Savior. Thank you for all of the membership of Orrville and all of our guests and all who have viewed this today by the means of these audio tapes and videotapes. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen.